This is EC 201, lecture 23. So we have so far in this course seen how the MOSFET comes about, how to make an amplifier with a MOSFET where the amplifier has got a lot of small signal gain, and that is the common source amplifier. The drawback of the common source amplifier is that even though you get a large gain, that gain becomes is dependent on a whole bunch of device parameters. The gain is of the form GMRL, and the GM is of the form UNCox W by L times VGS minus VT. And as temperature and process change, UNCox will change and so on. So the gain is large but is quite uncontrolled. And then we figured out how to use this uncontrolled large gain to make all the four control sources where the transfer parameters of the control sources, be it voltage gain, current gain, transimpedance or transadmittance, can all be made to be independent of the GM of the transistor as long as the transconductance of the transistor itself is sufficiently large. Okay. And this was accomplished through the use of negative feedback. And we found expressions for various transfer parameters, the input impedance, the output impedance and all that, with infinite GM, with finite GM, all sorts of stuff. And we also found the swing limits for several of these amplifiers. Today I will give you a more formal framework in which you can find the swing limits for any amplifier. Okay, not just what you have learned so far, but if you saw a strange looking circuit diagram, the first thing to do is to find the operating point. Then you replace all nonlinear elements with their incremental equivalent circuits. So what do you get now? You get an incremental circuit which is a linear network, where this linear network is only valid for incremental signals. So then you solve the linear network using all the tricks that you have learned in networks and EMC. Once you solve the linear network, you will be able to get the incremental voltage at every node and the incremental current through every branch. All right. From this, what do? You are now in a position to find the total voltage and total current at all nodes or through all branches. Okay. Which means that you are able to find swing limits as discussed now. To draw a picture, there is some arbitrary network. There are n number of MOSFETs inside the network. Let me consider one particular one, and the incremental input voltage to this network is Vs, and form is sinusoidal and is of the form Va sin omega t. Alright, and the output is taken elsewhere. You understand? Now, the first step, which is to find the operating point, will enable you to find Vg, Vs, and Vd, as well as ID. When we say operating point, this is what we mean. And we'll be able to do this for all MOSFETs inside the network. Or in the more general case, for all nonlinear devices inside the network. Then, you replace the transistor with its incremental equivalent circuit, which will... Once you replace the MOSFET with its incremental equivalent circuit, what you will end up with is a network where you replace the MOSFET with its incremental equivalent, which is, this is VG, this is VS, this is VD, and the strength of this transconductance is basically GM times VGS. What is the distinction between the V's in this diagram and the V's in this diagram? These are all the quiescent values, and this is a nonlinear network. And this, on the other hand, are all incremental quantities. This is incremental I, and this is a what kind of network? This is a linear network. If VS is the only independent source in the linear network, then what can you say about the branch, the increment, the branch currents and the branch node voltages in this network? If you have a linear network with only one independent source, okay, and for argument's sake, let's take it to be a sinusoid of the form VA sin omega t, then what comment can you make about all the branch currents and all the node voltages? They are all be directly proportional to VA. You understand? So, all branch currents and node voltages will be proportional to Vs. In our case, Vs is some VA sin omega. That makes sense? Which means the quiescent current, which means the total drain current in the MOSFET M1 is of the form ID plus sum is VA sin omega t times some constant. Okay? And this constant depends on what? It depends on all this multiplier here is coming from which network? It's coming from the incremental network. So it will depend on all incremental quantities only. Okay? Like GM, small signal RO, okay, that kind of thing. And which in turn will depend on the operating point. Quantities from the small signal equivalent circuits. And to find the limit for cutoff of M1, what do? I should equate the, I am trying to find the input amplitude at which the total current in this particular MOSFET becomes 0. So, the total current which is the quiescent current plus the incremental current must be equal to 0, which means that VA max, okay, is of the form ID divided by whatever constant we get here. I mean, this you all done in the context of specific examples before. All that I am saying is that, you know, there is nothing holy about a specific example. You can actually generalize this to other circuits, and not only other circuits, circuits with lot more MOSFETs. Okay. Similarly, the limit for triode operation of M1, how will you find this? The total VD, right, must be equal to the total VG minus the threshold voltage of the MOSFET. And the total VD is nothing but the quiescent value plus some constant 1 times Vs. Again, this constant will also depend only on incremental parameters of the various nonlinear devices in the circuit. And this must be equal to the total Vg, which is the quiescent value, plus another constant 2 times Vs minus Vt, which means that Va max, let me call the earlier one Va max 1, I will call this Va max 2, this is the form Vd minus Vg plus Vt divided by constant 2 minus constant 1. This constant 2 is the incremental transfer from the input source to the source of the particular MOSFET under consideration. And what is the absolute maximum voltage? Maximum VA, which still keeps M1 in saturation, is the minimum of VA max 1 and VA max 2. I mean, you intended to keep most of the transistors in the saturation region, and if the input signal becomes too large, you can always find you can always find VA which will push one or the other transistors into triode or cutoff. And the moment that happens, it will turn out that even if you have a fairly complicated circuit, you will find that the gain of the amplifier changes, because the equivalent circuit of the MOSFET changes to, I mean, it's gone from saturation where it was an ideal voltage controlled current source to either cutoff where the current becomes absolutely zero and the drain current is no longer dependent on the gate source voltage, or it has gone into triode where the output impedance of the current source has fallen, has become so low. In either of these cases, you will find typically that the transfer for function of the big circuit in which this particular MOSFET is embedded changes drastically, which is equivalent to saying that there is distortion in the output. If the gain of a block, of a black box, depends on the amplitude of the input signal, then what does it mean? It's no longer linear. And as we saw with the common source amplifier and, you know, several other amplifiers, this is catastrophic. I mean, when we saw that when the transistor goes into cutoff, the drain current doesn't change at all, which means that if you had a sine wave input, the output will simply get chopped off. And that in most applications is a complete no-no. So, VA, this quantity here, which is the minimum of VA max 1 and VA max 2, is the maximum amplitude that the input can have before this particular transistor M1 gets out of the intended region of operation. Now, if there are 40 MOSFETs inside the circuit, then what will you do? So all you need to do in principle is to repeat the above steps for all nonlinear devices in the network And then what will you do? You will get, for each MOSFET you will get 1 VA max. And the maximum input signal permissible before this whole network begins to distort is the absolute maximum VA is the minimum of the VA M1, VA M2. This is just a restatement of what we have been doing all along. And what is the, where is the biggest assumption here in this whole process? The only assumption here is this chart. The total drain current is equal to the incremental current, I mean the quiescent current plus the incremental current. But the assumption is that the incremental current is linearly dependent on the input source. That's the only assumption. And as I have pointed out with respect to specific cases, this is not entirely accurate, but is a very good first cut approximation to actually find, no amplifier will abruptly, the gain will never abruptly fall off. It will only be a gradual degradation as we saw with respect to the common source amplifier. But this is a very good first estimate for what the maximum signals must be. This approximation is justified in view of the simplicity that it brings into our calculations. Well, it seems extremely boring to go and do this for. If there are 20 transistors in a circuit, which you will certainly come to by the end of this course, hardly seems exciting to sit and do this for every transistor. Thankfully, with a little bit of experience, you'll be able to look at the circuit and figure out which transistor is the most likely culprit, which will limit the maximum input swing of the amplifier of the whole circuit as such. So you can actually go and only focus on that particular device. Most of the other devices will be quite comfortable and will never see such large signal swings. In any case, if you are lost, this is a sure shot way in which you will be able to figure things out. Is that clear? So that covers swing. What is the only issue we have not resolved so far? Think of all your circuits. Is there something that we have still not resolved? The last man standing is the infinite capacitor. We know that in practice, you can never get an infinite capacitor. So the next thing is to say, we'll put a large capacitor. And the obvious question that follows is, what is large? Okay. And as you have seen with the issue of transconductance in the transistor, we said we need a large transconductance. The meaning of large kept varying depending on the circumstance. So the same thing holds even here. So when we say we need a large capacitor, it will depend on, it presumably will change from circuit to circuit. And this is best illustrated using the common source as the example where we biased up the gate with a string of resistors. Our aim was in choosing this capacitor, what do we want ideally? It has to be large. Why? Because in the incremental circuit, you want it to become a short. So let's see what happens to this when C1 is not infinity, but in fact, finite. So initially, C1 is charged to what voltage? The voltage across this capacitor is, look at it in this way, is VVG, which happens to be VDD times RB by RA plus RB. In other words, the capacitance C1, which was charged to some potential VG, from your networks class, what do you know? Initial condition on the capacitor is equivalent to? If you have a linear network with capacitors and inductors, and then the inductor's initial currents are some I and the capacitor's initial voltages are V, you can get rid of all the initial conditions by associating, by thinking of all the capacitors as being uncharged, and you have a battery of value Vg in series with the capacitor. Is this familiar to everybody? A capacitor which is initially charged to Vg is equivalent to this, which means that, and this value is also C1. So, can you comment on what the incremental value of the equivalent of the capacitor charged to an initial value Vg will be? What do you understand by an incremental equivalent circuit? Well, network with only passive elements R, L and C. If I apply an excitation X1, I get some output Y1. If I apply X2, I get Y2. If I apply X1 plus X2, I will get Y1 plus Y2 only when the network is initially relaxed. If there are initial conditions in the network, the superposition is not valid. Which is why I am trying to show you that. So, this is precisely a case like that. So, where the capacitors are all initially charged, if C1 is a finite capacitor, it can be shown to be equivalent to a capacitor which is initially uncharged and a battery of value Vg in series with the capacitor. But for incremental signals, what do you think happens? In other words, I am trying to find the incremental equivalent of this chap. This was initially charged to some value Vg. This was a capacitance C1. And if, how would I find the incremental equivalent circuit? You already, the incremental equivalent of this is nothing but, what is it? It's only C1. Why? The voltage source will be a short. For incremental signals, even though the capacitor is initially charged, it's simply equivalent to C1. Now let's take a look at the input network here. Ideally, what do we want this to be? When you apply an incremental signal, when C1 was infinity, what would be the total potential at this node? If C1 is infinity, this node X, Vg is simply, if C1 was infinity, then it simply becomes Vg plus Vs. And that's how, I mean, that's how we derived the whole thing, right? We wanted the small signal to be riding over a quiescent value of Vg. Which means, this can only happen if the incremental value across the capacitor, C1 was infinity, what is the incremental value of the voltage across the capacitor? The capacitor behaves like a battery of value Vg. If you have a battery, what is the incremental equivalent of the battery? It's a short. So there is no voltage drop across the capacitor itself. So obviously we have to see what happens when C1 is made finite. If the incremental voltage across the capacitor was 0, then we are happy. The moment the incremental voltage across the capacitor is not 0, then presumably we have some trouble because the output voltage, the incremental value at Vx is not, actually I am sorry, this the incremental value at what is the incremental value at node X? It is Vs times Ra parallel Rb by Rs plus Ra parallel Rb. It will be Vg plus Vs only if Rs equals 0 or Ra parallel Rb is much, much larger than Rs. In either case, the value of the incremental voltage across the infinite capacitor is still 0. Now let's see what happens when C1 is not infinity but some finite value. Then, so what do? We replace every element here by its incremental equivalent circuit. In which case, what happens? So for finite C1, this is Rs. What is the incremental equivalent circuit of C1? It's a capacitor of value C1 itself. And what about these two guys here? RA parallel RB. So ground, because VDD, which is a battery, becomes an incremental short circuit. Now, what is the incremental voltage at Vx, at node X? It's easiest done in the frequency domain. It's Vs times RA parallel RB divided by RS plus 1 over j omega C1 plus RA parallel RB. More importantly, we are interested in the incremental voltage across the capacitor. So, the incremental voltage across the capacitor is seen to be what? Vs divided by Rs plus 1 over j omega C1 plus Ra parallel Rb. That's the total current flowing through this loop, incremental current flowing through this loop, into 1 over j omega C1, which means the incremental voltage across the capacitor can be simplified to Vs divided by 1 plus Rs plus Ra parallel Rb times j omega C1. And what did we want this incremental value across the capacitor to be? We wanted this to be what does this mean? Rs plus Ra parallel Rb times omega C1 must be much greater than 1. Clearly that is satisfied if C1 becomes infinity. If C1 is finite, then what does this mean? If C1 is finite, is it possible at all to satisfy this inequality? Okay, fine. For a given Rs, Ra parallel, and Ra and Rb, and a given C1, is it at all possible to satisfy this inequality? Okay, so this is only, so if for a fixed Ra, Rb, Rs and C1, the inequality is satisfied if the frequency is large enough. And what is the what do you mean by large here? If omega is much larger than 1 upon Rs plus Ra parallel Rb times C1. Is that clear? We know that it is not possible to have an infinite capacitor. How will we choose C1? We know we should choose it to be large. So you want to choose C1 so that C1 is greater than or equal to 1 over Rs plus Ra parallel Rb times the minimum frequency of the input signal that you can expect. This is the minimum frequency of the input signal. For example, if you are talking about audio applications, the human ear is sensitive from what frequency range to what frequency range? 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. So you will choose, if you are trying to build an audio amplifier, for example, you will choose C1 such that 1 over RS plus RA parallel RB times 2 pi times 20, please note omega is radians per second, is much, much larger than, you will choose C1 to be much greater than 1 over RS plus RA parallel RB times 2 pi times 20. Does that make sense? And that is the definition of large capacitor for you. So it depends on the minimum frequency of operation. It depends on RS, RA and RB. And in general, if you take any capacitor in the network, any of these so-called infinite capacitors, if I look across the capacitor, so this is the so-called infinite capacitor, which we are all looking at. Across C2, when you simplify the network completely at looking in through the terminals of C2, if I simplify the rest of the network, what will I get? You have an incremental circuit with C1 in it. I am telling you, I am asking you what the network, the entire network will look as seen from the terminals of C2. What does it look like? We will see, I mean, if you have a linear network and you are looking at it from taking any two arbitrary terminals, how does it look like? It looks like a voltage source in series with a resistor. So this is the incremental R Thevenin and this is some incremental voltage source. Because it's a linear network, the incremental voltage source must be directly proportional to the input, okay, some K1 times Vs. And the specific example that we saw here, what is the Thevenin resistance looking across C1? RS plus RA parallel RB. What is the value of the incremental voltage source across the Thevenin voltage source? It's Vs, okay. So the same thing will hold for any arbitrary linear network. So if I pick one of these so-called infinite capacitors and looked from the terminals of the capacitor, I will see an equivalent small signal voltage source which is proportional to Vs because it's a linear network and some R Thevenin. Okay, you have to sit and compute the R Thevenin from the linear network. And what is our interest? What do we want the incremental voltage across this capacitor C2 to be? We want it to be zero, which means what? So in this network, what is the incremental voltage across C2? It is K1 Vs divided by 1 plus R Thevenin j omega C2. I mean, the voltage across C2 is a low pass filtered version of K1 Vs. The transfer function of the low pass filter is 1 by 1 plus SCR. And if I am talking about sinusoidal steady state analysis, it is 1 by 1 plus J omega RC. So that's precisely what this denominator is. And we want this to be 0, which means we want the incremental voltage across the capacitor C2 to be 0, which means omega RTH times C2 must be much, much, much larger than 1. In other words, you want to choose C2 in such a way that, can you look at this and tell me how you must choose C2? C2 must be much, much greater than 1 over omega times R Thevenin. and where omega is the minimum omega that you expect this circuit to be processing. What you mean by an infinite capacitor or a large capacitor is not only dependent on the frequency of operation, it also depends, in the same circuit, different infinite capacitors can be. The meaning of large capacitor can vary from location to location because the R Thevenin across the capacitor can be vary. In the input example here, what the R Thevenin across the capacitor is nothing but RA parallel RB plus RS. What is the R Thevenin across this capacitor C2? Please note that for incremental signals, the transistor becomes a current source. So incrementally, this part is an open circuit as far as C2 is concerned. So it sees RL going to ground, it sees RL1 going to ground, okay, across. So at the output we see RL, RL1. So as far as the Thevenin equivalent is concerned, R Thevenin is RL plus RL1. So you see that, the considerations for choosing C2 are different from the considerations you use in choosing C1. So the key point is to choose the infinite capacitor to be much larger than 1 over the minimum frequency times the Thevenin equivalent incremental resistance across this capacitor. So if I plot, for example, in the common source amplifier, if I plot incremental gain as a function of frequency, incremental value of V out by Vs, the absolute value, what do you think I will get? You're in the lab, I gave you this common source amplifier with some of these capacitors. Obviously, these are not infinite capacitors. If I plot the gain as a function of input frequency, what do you think I will get? At very low frequencies, what will happen? The gain will be almost zero. Why? At very low frequencies, for finite C1, the impedance of a capacitor at low frequencies is very high. So, for very low frequencies, where low frequency is defined as a frequency much less than 1 over R Thevenin times C1, the incremental voltage drop across the capacitor is not zero, which means that, in fact, you will find that the incremental voltage across the capacitor is equal to Vs. So, if at very low frequencies, the incremental voltage across this capacitor is actually equal to K1 Vs, which basically means that the incremental voltage at the gate is actually zero, which means that the drain current is not changing, which means that the output voltage is not changing. So the incremental gain of the MOSFET of the common source amplifier that we are seeing right now at low frequencies for finite values of C1 and C2 will be zero. As I go on increasing the frequency, what do you think will happen to the gain? Eventually you will come to a point where the frequency becomes much larger than 1 over R Thevenin times C, in which case the capacitor can be considered an incremental short, in which case the gain will become GM times RL parallel RL1. At low frequencies it will start off from 0 and do this. And what happens as I go on increasing frequency, what do you think? In principle, from the knowledge that you have so far acquired, this must continue on till infinity. In practice, what happens is that the transistors have parasitic capacitances, which we will cover later on in this course, and there will be a limit to the bandwidth that will do something like this. It will fall off at very high frequencies because the transistor is not fast enough. It's not able to respond to the incremental voltage, okay, fast enough, and that translates to finite bandwidth. Okay? So, there is a low frequency limit below which the gain is very small. There is a high frequency limit which comes about because of inherent device limitations. The low frequency limit comes about simply because of these coupling capacitors. These capacitors which are supposed to act like batteries. So, this gain in the middle is called the mid-band gain. And this technique of using capacitors to add the incremental signal to the quiescent signal, quiescent value of the Fermi node, this is called AC coupling. And these capacitors are often called coupling capacitors. Okay. And this F min is due to this AC coupling. Okay. So there is a lower limit below which the amplifier will not work if you want to have these coupling capacitors, simply because you can't get large enough capacitors. And the maximum frequency is because of fundamental device limitations. So,